Okay, it should be on. Yeah, just gotta give it a little bit of time, I guess. Let me check something else. Hey, Paul Barr, welcome back. The MiG-26, welcome back. Thank you guys for coming back. A lot of things we had to kind of work through. Things were okay until we started, unfortunately. But anyway, again, James Richter, how you doing, Paul? Glad you guys came back. So again, we are going to have Gregor here. And if you can, just go ahead, type in the letter Q if you have questions for him, and we'll sift through them and sort through them all. And we'll just go ahead and get started with this straight away. So again, Ted Oakley is going to be coming up, and then we have Lynette Zhang who's going to be coming up. So please do go ahead and subscribe, hit that bell to be notified, and then we'll get going with them on those interviews coming up. And today we're going to get going with Gregor Gregersen, founder of Silver Bullion and the Safe House, formerly a senior data architect at Commerce Bank, Germany's second largest bank. And Gregor saw how Lehman Brothers went bankrupt and how the financial system is now like a house of cards. I think a lot of us, we kind of feel the same way here, but not wanting to be invested in it materially and knowing another financial crisis will occur, Gregor moved his assets into physical gold and silver and stored it in a manner that removes counterparty risk and jurisdictional risk as well. And with that, I'd like to welcome Gregor Gregersen aboard. How are you doing, Gregor? Welcome to SBTV. Good morning.
Hello, Patrick. Hello, everybody.
Glad to have you back. Sorry to kind of go through all of these crazy things that went on, but from time to time it happens. So let's get this going. Gregor, can I first start asking you how you got interested in precious metals?
Well, for me, I was sort of thrown into the middle of it all when I was working at Commerzbank in 2008 and the after effects of Lehman Brothers. And, you know, seeing that from essentially a trading room, I was building software system at the time for the bank. And I was reading Mike Maloney's book, Investing in Gold and Silver, and I think that had a big effect on me, especially because when I went out and I tried to buy some physical gold and silver, it became clear that nobody was selling. And that's when you got to see the difference between paper and physical, especially because paper kept on falling and silver went down to $9.50 at the time. But physical, you had to pay $30 or $36 to try and find an American Eagle on the secondary market. And I went through 12 different banks in the Frankfurt areas and bullion dealers, nobody had it. And I think that was sort of the defining moment for me where I said, they're going to have a bigger crisis. And gold and silver is obviously what people want to have in a crisis. And it makes sense to own some of that because it's one of the few things you can own which is intrinsically valuable. And that's how it started.
Okay. And how about silver bullion? How did you basically by yourself start silver bullion?
Well, I was in Germany on a project for about 4 months. So by the time I got back to Singapore, it was end of December, early 2009, and I tried to figure out a way to own some silver for myself. And in Singapore at the time, there was no good way of, there was nobody selling silver. So once the market had recovered and there was a little bit of liquidity coming back, and it was clear that, you know, the financial system will continue to work, at least for now. I looked for ways to ship silver into Singapore. And at the time, there was a sales tax, or VAT actually, which meant you have to pay 7% on import. And I figured, well, why don't I start a company? Why don't I GST register it? And then I can buy the bullion under the company name instead of my own. And so it really started as a way for myself to own silver And gold was secondary, but primarily silver. And I didn't know if anybody was interested in buying it as well, but I just wanted to own it myself. And that's also where Bullion started. And because of my background as a software engineer, I said, well, why don't I build a website with live pricing and live inventory settings? And I see if anybody else is interested to buy some of it. And if I can sell some silver to the person and I can make a bit of a margin, I can buy more silver. That's essentially how it started. And if nobody wanted to buy anything, it was okay too, because I literally kept the silver under my bed at the time, back in 2009. And, you know, so it would be okay too. But it really started as a way for me to own silver myself. And then, you know, it seemed to make sense to see if anybody else wanted to own it as well.
Okay. And Silver Bullion, it is the company that buys and sells precious metals. It does store precious metals, and it has become a company that has a focus on wealth protection, systemic wealth protection. And can you tell us in your view, or maybe even how do you define systemic wealth protection, and how can you achieve wealth protection?
Yes. So I guess I came into precious metals because of what I experienced in 2008, not because I happened to be into it. So in 2008, we saw the near collapse of the financial system. You have to understand that the financial system is extremely leveraged. It's extremely interdependent between the banks. So I used to work on structured product desk, which means I used to build derivative with quants for a while. And when you do that, you're essentially taking different derivative from different banks, you're putting it together, and say you have risk 100 on that side, and you have risk 99 from that side, and you put it together in a way that you only have risk 1, in a way that gives you some sort of tax benefit or creates some sort of product. Now, as long as everything works as it should be, your risk is 1. But if one of the banks goes bankrupt, suddenly your risk becomes 100 again. And that can cause another bank to go bankrupt and so on. So once you're in that world, you realize how fragile really it is and why we came so close to, you know, a financial meltdown back in 2008. So when I'm talking about systemic wealth protection, I'm talking about things not recovering so well, people losing trust, because at the end of the day, the whole system is based on trust. One bank is trusting that another bank will make good on their derivative obligations to the other bank. The whole banking system is also based on the currencies that's underlying everything to be valuable, whether it's the US dollar and so on. So you have counterparty risk. And when you talk about counterparty risk, not just counterparty risk with the entity you're dealing with, but with the entities that that entity is dealing with. So, make a story short, you might have some company in Italy go bankrupt, and you might be based in the US, but suddenly your local bank is going to trouble. So, once you put that in, and you put in the fact that the United States and other countries are printing so much cash and so much money, it becomes very worrisome, because the system just becomes more and more fragile, but yet there's nothing to counteract it, because people don't feel that it's a problem. And that's all it is about the psychology of people. But if that psychology ever changes, then you have a major problem. Then things can change very quickly. I like to liken it, you know, Jim Richards had a very good example, I think, where there's a critical point, and it's best illustrated when people are watching a movie and say one person gets up and runs towards the exit. Well, probably most people are not going to be concerned about that, because maybe he needs to go to the toilet or something. But if 5 or 6 people get up and run towards the exit, the chance is high that a 7th or 8th person is going to also run towards the exit, just because they're not sure what's happening. There's too many people which are trying to get out. Maybe there's a bomb, maybe there's a snake, something else. And when that 7 or 8 person is running out, then chances are the whole cinema is going to run out, because everybody has a threshold on how many people are running out. And so I feel our financial system, our monetary system and so on, everybody has a certain threshold when they start saying, I'm no longer comfortable putting my money into this. And coming from that system, I guess one of the early ones which, decided that I don't want to have my money in the system and I want to put in something intrinsically valuable like gold and silver. So as more and more people sort of end up joining this sort of mentality, there can be that critical mass. And that's when things can go downhill very quickly. So my goal was initially for myself, and then, it became quite a sizable business. I mean, we had $1.2 billion in sales, Singapore dollars, so about over 900 million US dollars. It became my mission to really build the safest way to store wealth that is independent of the financial system, independent of the monetary system, in a safe jurisdiction, in a way that no matter what happens, it is a backup plan. It is something that can be sure that gold, that silver, that wealth is going to be there no matter what. And that was essentially the goal of what I set out to build.
Okay, that story's pretty interesting. My wife and I, we were actually at the theater watching a movie, and I had smelled smoke, and I had told my wife, hey, something's a bit off here. And the usher came in, and she just basically stood by the screen and looked at us. And I'm like, I still smell smoke. How come she's not, asking us to leave? So anyway, I got up and left. We were the first ones to leave, and the corridors were actually filled with smoke. And we were gone. We weren't going to wait, but we were kind of wondering, hey, how come she didn't tell us to get out? So sometimes you really got to be aware of things on your own. So that's a great point. Another thing, people often say is gold and silver, if you don't hold it, you don't own it. What would you say to that? What's your opinion on that?
I think that's a very good statement. I think it's very important because most of the times that's true. Oftentimes when you store gold or silver somewhere, or especially with funds and so on, these things are not in your name. These things are essentially on the balance sheet of an entity which then issues IOUs for you. Or in many cases, very often people think that they own precious metals when there are no precious metals. Or it's an unallocated system where it's been sold to many different people. So there's a lot of shenanigans. There's been class action lawsuits going on against Morgan Stanley. I believe it was back in the 90s, and Morgan Stanley lost the cause. And, they paid a fine and said, well, it's industry practice not to have gold and silver, even though they charge storage fees. So absolutely. I mean, it's a statement which you should be very aware of. And I'm actually telling people so as well, because they need to be sure how they store. And because of that, what we set out to do is to go through very great lengths to make sure and prove to you that when you're storing with us, that bullion is your private property, which you're owning. And the way we do it is that when you buy something for storage, you cannot buy, say, 52.7 ounces of silver, because by definition, that's always an IOU. Instead, you need to buy an actual bar of silver, let's say 100 ounces or 1,000 ounces of silver or gold. And that bar, by unique serial number, is then sold to you via an invoice. And that's the important thing. An invoice is actually an extremely important document because it signifies the transfer of ownership from the seller's buyer sheet over to the purchaser, which in this case is the customer. So we then are an agent who stores the gold for you, who insures it, who provides liquidity, and gives you an option to collateralize it. But it's not on our balance sheet. So theoretically, if we were to go bankrupt, our creditors cannot get to that gold and silver. On top of that, we actually test the bullion to make sure it's real. We have what's called a parcel ownership list, where essentially we list the anonymous ID of each storage customer, along with the bars by serial number which are being owed, and that's made available to all customers. And the reason we do that, it's the best way to prove that we did not sell the same bar to the same customers. And that's what we call the parcel ownership list. And then lastly, we're having two separate auditors. One is Bureau Veritas, one is Ernst & Young. Bureau Veritas checks the physical holdings 3 times per year, and Ernst & Young comes in once per year. So on top of that, you're getting a photo. You're getting a photo of your parcel. So the combination of you owning the physical bullion, we are, say, invoice, the parcel ownership list, the physical auditors coming in 4 times per year, and the photos you're getting, you essentially can be very sure that the bullion is there, that the bullion is yours, and that the bullion is genuine. That's why we do the testing, and we are guaranteeing the bullion. And we own, as a company, debt-free 4,000 ounces of gold and about 700,000 ounces of silver. So if there's any issue, we will be replacing it. But you know, we know there are no issues because of the testing process. So we are doing all of these things, which are not common in the industry. And I believe we're the only ones doing all of these things because the right way to thing to do. And because my goal, first of all, is to create such sort of clarity, such sort of transparency, and such sort of what I call systemic wealth protection, because we want to make sure that when things go bad and the shit hits the fan, as we say, you know, you can sleep soundly, that gold is going to be there and it's going to appreciate, because during a crisis, the physical will definitely go up in value, even though the paper silver might go down at first. So that's essentially, you know, what I have to say to it. But I like to tell people about, you know, if you don't own it, if you can't touch it, you don't own it, because it's a very visual way of realizing that, you know, you should not be blindly trusting where you put your gold and silver.
Okay, with what you said, that's pretty interesting, because I guess, come to think of it, you know, if a person should buy gold and silver from a company, and then that company goes ahead and stores it in a vault, let's say a third-party vault, your gold and silver is probably not tested, so there's no way to really even get an independent confirmation that you have real gold, real silver there. Would that be correct?
Yes. The way the industry works is it's very stratified. When you're dealing with somebody, you're normally dealing with a bank, a bullion dealer, a fund, an online website. In the vast majority of cases, that entity is not storing the gold. They're outsourcing it to a storage company. Oftentimes, these are companies like Malka, Amit, Lumi, Springs. These tend to be the big, you know, storage companies. And these companies will store the gold or silver on a set or contain basis. So they're saying, if Bank X is sending me 10 kilos of gold, I'm getting the bag with the gold, I'm recording the numbers that I'm getting, I'm putting it there for storage. If you want it back, you tell me, I give it to you. But the vault takes no responsibility on verifying whether that's real gold or not. So on the other hand, the bank or the dealer, they normally never get to see the gold because they purchased it from somewhere and it's going into the vault and it's a set of contained basis. So if there's an issue with the gold, who's responsible for it? Well, you would think it will be the entities that sold it to you. But, you know, do you have it black and white? Because oftentimes that ends up being lawsuits. Is there a really clear, you know, sort of guarantee behind it? And normally, you don't find that clearly. So in our case, you have what I call a genuinity guarantee, that if there's any issue with that, we will replace it right away. And it's spelled out clearly in our terms and conditions. And it's made possible because we created a decade worth of testing experience using 5 different testing methods to make sure it really is real gold or silver.
Okay, so with this affinity for precious metals, a man who stored silver under his bed and met people at the train station to go ahead and give them the silver that they purchased, you've now come on a path that has led you to build this.
We'll be right back.
So what you're seeing here is there is a new wall that is only being renovated. One of the key features here is that the front, you're seeing this bay, it's actually onyx, 5 millimeter onyx, surrounded by 1 centimeter of glass. And when you have sunlight going through that, you essentially get a golden glow, you can see here now. And that's the effect we are wanting to go for. It's a very natural sort of thing. Now, if you're in the vault, it's the first level. You're heading towards the left, basically. Your safe house, which is all vault and facility. And within it, we have 10 different gold vaults. And
I'll just continue playing. Sorry about that. I'll just let it play.
Yep. And the main feature of this room is that it's a huge room, essentially. It's 32 meters high, 20,000 square feet large. And we're able to flex over 12 meters high. And that's what you're seeing here. So it's a very unique way of doing it. 24 meters high, we actually have an area where people can look into the vault. And the fourth and fifth floor, which is what you're seeing here where the stairs are, this is an area where we can have wealth managers coming, queen clients, and essentially get to see, look into what's going to be the largest vault in the world, vault room definitely. And then at night, we can put LED lights behind the onyx, and we can essentially reverse that effect you saw earlier and have the building create this golden glow. On top of that, we're very close to Singapore Airport, so when you land in Singapore and you're sitting on the left side of the plane and the wind is right and the right airline is used, you would essentially be landing and seeing it on your left side. So it's quite a build.
Okay, so we'll get into that. You know, the reserve, can you tell us about it? You kind of narrated through it with us here, but can you tell us a bit about it and what led you to build the world's highest capacity mega vault?
Yeah, so when you essentially, like you mentioned, I started off putting silver under my bed, back in 2009, because I didn't know there was an event for gold and silver, or whether I was the only one, wanting to own physical metals. And after about $700,000 in sales, I realized, okay, it's there is demand, let's get an office. Then by 2013, we started with a storage of bullion, and we used some of third-party vault operators to store for us. And the two problems that I faced, which I didn't accept, was A, the contract with the vault operator said that if the bullion mysteriously disappears, it was not going to be covered, and I have to indemnify the vault operator against mysterious disappearance of my gold or silver. Which of course didn't sound good at all. The other problem was I had to sign a contract which stated that under force majeure, if any government comes and confiscates, nationalizes, or otherwise if cheats the gold or silver stored with the vault operator, I have to identify the vault operator against that. And again, I didn't see a point of doing that. If I'm storing my gold in Singapore, which I believe to be a good jurisdiction, why should I sign a force majeure clause saying that any government, it should only be the Singapore government? So that's essentially why we ended up starting our own vault, which was the safe house. And the safe house, we started that in 2014, 2015, and ended up growing. We had a capacity of around 600 tons, but then because we use a portion of it for safe deposit boxes, its actual capacity was more like 450 tons or so. And by 2020, when COVID started coming, it became clear that we were running out of space in the old facility. And we knew for a while that we had to look for a location. So we were looking at that point already for 2 years for a place. And around that time, we found what I would sort of call almost as the perfect building to build a vault, which is what you just saw, which is the reserve. Now, when you build a vault like this, essentially you need to find a place which has good floor loading. And the reserve was ideal for that. And we managed to get it because of COVID at a very good sort of price. We got at 30-40% less than it would have cost otherwise. And we essentially, you know, even though it's a large building, we said, okay, this is the right place. We're getting at a price which is exceptionally good. And it makes sense to go in and buy it. And by buying it, we essentially solved another big problem, which is even though we had our own vault, and we solved the jurisdictional issues and the insurance issues, because we are covering mysterious disappearance, and we make sure we're only falling under Singapore jurisdiction, we still had a landlord to deal with. And if you're storing large amounts of bullion, well, at some point the landlord might just say, you know what, I'm going to triple or quadruple your rent because it's so hard for you to establish yourself here. So by building our own building, we are now fully vertically integrated. And that essentially allows us to provide a really long-term storage. And it allows us to provide this really, really high capacity through the vault.
Okay, yeah, I've seen it. It is pretty massive. We got a question here from Mr. Nguyen. Will the building be used in the next James Bond movie?
You know, that was the first question I asked as well when we bought it. You know, when you visit it, you essentially walk in. The whole building is built around this massive room, which you saw a little bit. And, you know, the first question becomes, okay, can you imagine Tom Cruise or somebody rappelling down the walls and, you know, coming down? So long story is, I don't know. We did have some requests for some show to actually do it in our old vault. And our old vault actually is become somewhat famous because it's being used. BBC and Bloomberg took a number of photos of it, and these photos have been shown in all kind of enterprises or newspapers afterwards. There was even some report where they showed our vault to describe the Bank of England of all places. It was quite funny. So I believe that once the vault is ready and completed, Bloomberg and other entities are already there wanting to take photos, and you know, maybe we'll end up having it featured somewhere.
Look forward to that. Why did you choose the name The Reserve?
So the idea is to create a safe haven asset storage location, something that, you know, no matter what happens in the world, is going to be a safe place for your assets. And so the name Reserve seemed appropriate because it sort of means that when everything else fails, you know, you have that reserve. So it's like in a car, essentially, you have your gas reserve to make sure that there's still something there. And then, you know, there's the obvious question, well, what about the Federal Reserve? And is it coming from that? And yeah, it's a bit of a play on words. It kind of seemed to make sense as well, because as many viewers probably know, the Federal Reserve doesn't have reserves and it's not federal. So we wanted to build a reserve which truly has reserves.
Okay. And I understand your plan is to stack silver 12 meters high. I'd imagine this puts incredible stress on the floor loads, which you've kind of touched on here. And second, how do you intend to silver up, to stack silver so high?
Yeah, so if you build a vault, it's a very unique sort of thing you're doing. First of all, you need to find a place, you know, that's sort of presentable. The price still of the facility still have to be within reason, because obviously you can only charge so much rent or fees. But then the thing that most people don't realize is floor loading is critical, because silver is 11 and a half times as heavy as water. Gold is about 19.3 times as heavy as water. So if you want to stack silver up very quickly, you end up putting a lot of stress on that floor. And the floor often becomes your limiting factor of how much bullion you can put up there, more than the height of the building typically. Now, in our case, we have 32 meter high ceilings in the main room, so height will never be the issue. But the floor loading, it's really the limiting factor. And what we thought out to try and find was a 30 kilonewton floor loading. Kilonewton is a typical values that you use to measure floor, and it means 30 kilonewton means you put 30 tons of silver or gold or anything into a square meter. And to give you an idea, your typical car park is about 2 kilonewtons. So if you have a 30 kilonewton floor, you have 15 times as much strength as a typical car park. In our case, our building has 90 kilonewtons. So it's 45 times as strong as a normal car park. And that's exceptionally high. I mean, there are very few buildings that have such sort of floor loading capacity. And that's what we are doing is so unique. Being able to put silver 12 meters high, that's only possible because the floor is a 1 meter thick concrete slab, essentially, with reinforced that goes 32 meters, that's about 100 feet, down into the ground to spread that weight. And so when we bought that building, we are so lucky to get a building with that sort of floor loading. It was extremely expensive to build that. And the building before was used as a logistics center with a huge, massive automatic retrieval and storage systems there. We had to remove all of that. That happened last year. And now that we removed it, essentially that floor is going to be prepared with the 12-meter high racking. And then we can combine the high security vaulting with the high efficiency reach truck systems. And that combination allows us to store 12 meters high. And what that means is we can store silver much, much more efficiently, close to an order of magnitude more efficiently than a normal vault can. And that essentially means that that room, that main silver room, can store almost 10,000 tons of silver. And then with the other facility, with the other two floors, we're talking about 15,000 tons. And 15,000 tons, that's about 480 million ounces of silver. So that's about 28% of the above ground holdings of silver, as reported by the Silver Institute. It's more silver than is in COMEX. It's 3.5 times the amount of silver that is stored in the Shanghai Gold Exchange. I believe JP Morgan is rumored to have about 130 million ounces of silver, so we can store 3.5 JP Morgans essentially in this facility. And it's not the largest vault in the world by size, but it's the highest capacity vault because we're able to store so efficiently. And the floor loading, is what enables us to do it. So that's one thing I'm very excited about.
Okay. Can I ask you, in fact, let me back up a bit here. How about the other features such as the amount of steel being used, the beautiful onyx stones that are going to be up on the facade? Could you give us an idea of the massive amounts of construction material being used?
Yeah, so the facility itself is using about 1,600 square meters of onyx. So onyx is essentially very thin. It's just 5 millimeters because we want, sun to go through it and creates a golden glow effect. And then you have a 1 centimeter worth of glass on both sides. Now, you might ask, if you're building a vault, isn't that isn't glass a bad way of securing it? Yes, it is, but it's actually a two-vault structure. So on the lower levels where the storage is, you actually have an outside wall, which is what you're seeing. And then you have the inside wall, which is like the harder security walls. One of the reasons we're doing that is because of the way the shape of the building, whereas the lower levels actually a little bit lower than the higher levels are going out a little bit. And so what that allows us to do is on the higher floors, we can actually use this glass to create the facade. So on the fourth and fifth floor, you can look through that glass. But then on the three lower floors, essentially it's an outside wall with the inside wall behind it. And one of the nice side effects is that it greatly reduces the cooling needs of the building. And it acts as, you know, a very nice and creates a very clean sort of setup. Now, we have about 1,600 square meters of onyx that's being needed. These panels are about 2 meters by close to 1 meter. And each one is about a quarter ton, 250 kilos to set up. So the big steel beams being set up to you know, make all of this work. And so onyx will actually clad about 2/5 of the building. So the other 3/5 is concrete, and then there's some aluminium type around it to give it, you know, a certain shape and so on. Now, the good thing is we were able to lock in almost all of those material costs before prices went up. We did that early last year, and you know, so we avoided much of the issues of the commodity prices, which are all going up now. On top of that, we are also building 15 class 2 vaults. So we just had delivery of about, I believe it was 35 containers of vault steel. These are essentially vault 15 centimeter thick composite steel vaults. And that was about 350 tons of steel that's been coming in. And these will be assembled into these class 2 vaults, which essentially about 14 of these will be made available for third parties to rent. So 350 steels coming from there. And I'll have to give you some more stats, you know, when everything is done on the other materials. But the good thing is that the building itself is already a massively strong building. Even say fourth floor, for example, is already 30 kilonewtons worth of floor loading. So the fourth floor is more than most warehouses can handle on the first floor. And that means that there's not a lot of strengthening that's being needs to be done. It's mostly about giving it the facade, building the actual steel gold vaults, and setting up these kind of things. Yeah. But 350 tons of class 2 walls coming in. That's a huge order.
Okay, some natural question here. How is the reserve being funded?
So the reserve, the first thing to know is we essentially have a team of 15 people now building it with the architectural team. And when I started off, you know, it's such a grandiose, it's such an amazing sort of design, right? I didn't start off thinking to do something like this. But it turned out that one of very talented architects in Singapore, he said, look, I will quit my job if I can build this thing for you. And he did. And he came up with this design. And I told him, look, if you're going to build this, I need value. I need to make sure that this project is going to be... I know it's not going to be cheap, but it can become too expensive. So I think we did an amazing job to sort of go to top companies out there and tell them and sell the design, because it turns out that if you're building something truly unique, people want to be part of the project. And so they're willing to work almost at cost because they want their portfolio value. They want to be able to say, I worked on that project. And because I worked on it, you know, I can ask more for more money with my next project. So because of that, and because when you go with a really high price architect, an architect might want as much as 30% of the project cost in the design fees. We are paying a tiny fraction of that. So I think when all is said and done, I believe we're able to build this facility about half the cost of what you would pay for if you were to do it in traditional ways. So that's one part of it. The second part is we essentially have whatever profits there was in the company, we essentially reinvested it in the company, and we accumulated more gold and silver, especially last, 2020, when silver fell down to $12. I was sort of kicking and screaming and telling people, guys, the gold-silver ratio is 120 to 1. It's never been that high in history. Silver has never been that cheap. It makes sense to buy. And, you know, as a company, we also ended up buying, moving all silver, and then it went back up to 24. So make a long story short, we have enough assets in the company that if we need to, we could actually pay for that renovation outright. To give you an idea, the building, the purchase of it was 18.2 million Singapore dollars. It used to be $28 million just a year before. So we managed to get it at 18 million. And that was roughly the net profit after taxes that Silver Bullion had in 2020. So we were able to essentially buy the building with our 2020 net profit. And that was a really good year for us. But 2021 also used to be very good. And so now it's just a matter of doing the renovation. So we could do it alone. But having said that, I'm looking to bring in some strategic partners for it, because it not just for the money, but in order to be able to make use of such a big building. Because it's so much capacity. We are essentially having talks with other storage providers. We're in talk with auction houses. We are in talk with other vault operators. We're in talks with other bullion dealers as well, or people in wealth protection circle, because we are figuring we want to build a facility and we want to have people that we can trust and come in, and we don't have to be running all of it. So essentially, we have other parties come in as well, because I think it's the right thing to do. And we're also talking with some other parties, which I can announce at a later time, I think, which are coming in. But essentially, we could fund it all in-house, but I expect to be raising some money through some a bit of equity sales in order to reduce the amount of money we have to pay on the renovation ourselves.
Okay. During this time of the pandemic, I'd imagine there were significant challenges in getting the project off the ground. How did this affect the plans for the reserve?
Yeah, so original plan, you know, to be honest, my experience was with creating a vault, a safe house originally, right, in 2013-14, and that was a 10,000 square foot facility. And it was in a building which was already standing there. So going out and doing some major renovation on a 180,000 square foot facility is something very different. And so original plans for renovation, they were sort of optimistic, because we are hoping to actually be able to be done by now. But then, of course, COVID-19 sort of came in and made everything a lot slower. And it turns out to be a lot more complicated to build a building like this than I imagined at first. I mean, in Singapore, you need to have approval from 12 different governmental agencies. I mean, it goes from the fire department, the airport authorities. You know, when you have the lights sort of on the building, you need to get permission from Singapore Air Force, as well as the airport as well. All kind of studies that have to go in. The transport authority has to have to say, environmental agencies, and so on and so on. So 12 different agencies. And then when you're in the pandemic, of course, it's not the government's first priority to get, you know, construction permits out. They have to deal with the pandemic first. So there are delays in all of this. Also, buying a building in Singapore, you need more some money. You know, it was a 6-month project to get it approved. You have to pretty much create a business plan explain exactly what you want to do, because Singapore government wants to make sure the buildings put to a productive use, essentially. So all of these things took time to get these governmental sort of steps through them. And then as you do it, you know, you have to do appeals sometimes, because, for example, you need to have a fire lift every 60 square meters, within 60 meters from any sort of point in the building, and all the other fire things. So you have to work through it. You have to make sure it's working with the wall security and all these things. So that took longer than expected. And then, of course, the pandemic. But, you know, when the pandemic first hit, you ended up with a huge shortage of manpower, because especially in Singapore, most of the people who are doing the actual work down on the ground, they tend to be coming from places like Pakistan, Philippines, you know, things like that. And when COVID happened, basically the borders were closed and it was difficult to get new workers in. And then when you had the lockdown, of course, they couldn't work. And then once you had one case where you had a COVID case, you would have quarantine for, you know, a lot of people back when there was a strict quarantine policy. So what we were lucky with is that we managed to create the plans, lock in the materials, and get the key facade contracts awarded very early, which means that we were able to lock in the onyx and the glass and the aluminium and all the other things, the wall panels, at a time when there was no demand. And so we got a low price. And since the labor, well, we pretty much had to wait because the actual implementation of it, the workers coming and building it, that's something which is starting today, of all places. We actually, right now, as we're speaking, we're giving over the construction area to the main contractor, and works are starting. And Singapore has greatly loosened quarantine requirements and is slowly opening the borders again, so it's easier to get the workers in. So it took a lot of negotiations, but I think we are on a good way now. And that's why we announced the project now, because before then, we weren't yet 100% sure whether the design as presented was going to be there. We weren't sure whether the stairs that you saw in the video, whether we're going to do these or whether we're going to skip them and not do them. So it all sort of had to be finalized and be certain before we wanted to go out and present it. And it is all certain now, works are starting and we're essentially good to go. And COVID was definitely a challenge, but, you know, I think we made the most out of it.
Yeah, yes, there's some great points there to remember. You know, in that video that we just watched a little while ago, we saw some beautiful lounge areas. We saw some private spaces. And I understand these are open for wealth managers and family offices. Can you tell us a bit about this?
Yeah, so the first three floors of the building are essentially for storage. And then the fourth and fifth floors are it's more an office type of environment. It's the sixth floor as well. We have six floors, but sixth floor is very small. So the fourth floor is where we are going to have silver bullion offices. So customer service will be there, or back end offices will be there. Our software engineering side, a little bit, will all be sitting there. We then have Cash, which is a digitization company with a gold token. We then have Excess, which is a company which will be operating high-end watch workshop. So we have watchmakers from Rolex, high complication people from AP coming in, polishers and so on. And the idea is that there's a 2,500 square foot watch workshop which can authenticate and restore watches. Now, the reason that's a big deal is watches are become very valuable, and they are an asset class in itself. I've sort of learned that my own way when I was in Hong Kong and looking at some of these secondhand sort of exchange places. And if we can authenticate, make sure it's real, and we can provide liquidity for these watches, it's actually quite easy because there's a big scarcity of the high-end watches. Then we can also build a specialty vault. And so on the fourth floor, we are going to be having a watch specialty vault where we expect to have about 2,000 watches. Each one has a little winder to keep it winded up, and we have a top-of-the-line workshop to make sure they're being well taken care of. And our plan is to allow these watches to become collateralized. And in the industry, you know, you have pawn shops and so on, which are collateralizing some of these watches at 18%. Well, we'll be able to do it at 6 or 7%. And the watch market is huge. And so when we're talking about the reserve, we're talking about having alternative assets, not just bullion, but essentially allowing for said watch, high-end watch area as well. On top of that, we have an area where we are now in the final talks with URA, with Singapore government, essentially, to get permission to be able to conduct auctions. And assuming we are getting said, we'll be able to invite auction houses to come in, because a lot of auctions have been happening in Hong Kong because there was no GST, there was no sales tax. But now with what's happening in Hong Kong, less and less people really want to be there, especially with the COVID-19 policies, the zero COVID policies. I mean, it's dreadful what they're doing there. So all of that wealth is going out, and it makes a lot of sense for that to come to Singapore. As a matter of fact, as a side note, the American Chamber of Commerce in Hong Kong did a survey, and it turned out that 80% of expats want to go to Singapore now after leaving Hong Kong. So as we can do auctions, we can essentially provide a facility which is bonded, because our vault is a bonded facility, which means it's a tax-free facility. We have the insurance, we have the security, we have the nice facilities that you saw. So I believe it will be a good place for auction houses to come in. And because the fourth floor has that high floor loading, we're actually having four art vaults, which are the full class two high-end vaults that insurance, you know, is considered the gold standard for high-end storage. Then you got the nitrogen fire suppression systems, you have the climate control, you have the humidity controls. You get all these things that you need to have art there as well. So that's what the fourth floor is. On top of that, we have 12,500 safe deposit boxes, and we have a presentation hall. So it's actually two areas that can be used for auctions. One can hold up to 100 people, and another one is a smaller one for about 20 people. And we have full catering capability. So we can actually host up to 50 people with sort of a full dinner sort of capabilities. That's the plan. And that's essentially why you want to create environments that is welcoming and can sort of host these sort of events. And that's the fourth floor. And you saw the stairs, which are going from the fourth floor up to the fifth floor. Now, the fifth floor, you have a barista, a high-end coffee kind of area. And most of that floor, which is 32,000 square foot, I would say about 20,000 square foot of that, is meeting rooms. And so will be an area where essentially you can look down into the main vault from 24 meters height. And meeting rooms for wealth managers to basically meet with their clients. And the wealth manager can essentially tell the clients, look, you can literally see the bullion down there. I can go down every day and check the gold and silver is there. And say, meaning safe house is checking on me, I'm checking on them. And, you know, the bet, or what I believe, is that more and more people in this world are so starting to think the way I'm thinking, that you ought to be owning physical gold and silver and not just an IOU. So, you know, people might no longer want to buy, say, the GLD on the New York Stock Exchange or NASDAQ. Maybe they do want the physical silver or gold. And as more people are coming with those demands, and they're going to wealth managers, and they're going to a bank, the banks don't have good solutions for that. And they're all sort of the same, you know, there's no experience there. You're just going to send you somewhere else to buy something that you cannot see, where you can just hope that it's all there. So I'm thinking that if we have a facility where family office, where a private bank, where, you know, high net worth individuals or not high net worth individuals can come and can see for themselves, see how we test, see the bullion, see the insurance, see everything, and do it in a way that it's an experience. I think that's something that will eventually get enough people to want to store the bullion in something like this, that the wealth manager will bring the customers there. And so in many ways, we are opening what we are doing. So it's not just silver bullion, but there are other entities that can come in as well and make use of the systems and standards that we created. Because I believe that what I want to do is not just earn money out of it. I never went into this to earn money as a primary motive. I came into it because I wanted to build a better system that people can trust and so that people can sort of go towards when things go bad. That's really what it's about. And I can have other people come in with that, other entities, and also better. And we have so much space in this new facility, it's 180,000 square foot, that we can afford to do that. And we have another 10,000 square foot, which essentially will be office space that we can rent out to parties that want to get an office there. If you go to cereserve.sg, essentially you can see some of these areas.
Okay, we'll head on to the website in just a bit. I want to bring in just a few questions here. We had Richie Rich, gold and silver spot price in short and long term. He's wondering what your best guess would be, and should he buy more gold if he has already a substantial amount of silver?
So short term is anybody's guess. We had a discussion in silver bullion last week because when the invasion of the Ukraine happened, gold and silver were spiking, right? I mean, silver went up for over a dollar in a day, and then suddenly it sort of started coming down again. And if you look at nickel kept on going up. So why would silver and gold, you know, suddenly fall? And, you know, Patrick actually put out a chart showing that whenever there's a quick uptick in gold and silver prices, you know, somebody comes in and sells a lot of paper silver, because the price of silver is determined in the future markets, not on the physical markets. So if somebody wants to bring down the price of silver, you can essentially go on the future markets, you create silver in air, leverage it 10 times, and then sell it and create downward pressure. So because of that, you know, I think we'll probably see an appreciation of silver and gold, but we probably don't see a huge one until we have some really critical event happening. And that critical event, I believe, that, you know, it comes back down to the type of writings that Ray Dalio did. I think Ray Dalio is doing an amazing job explaining how reserve currencies tend to switch from one to another, and how when you go from one reserve currency to another one, you have this instability. And I think during that time, as the world sort of adjusts, as the financial system adjusts to a new sort of reality, I think that's when the time for gold and silver is going to be to really shine, and when we're going to see a difference between the physical silver and the paper silver. And so the way I will play it and the way I'm playing it is I'm just buying the physical silver. I don't leverage it typically. I just buy it and I hold it and I somewhat forget about it. Same thing with gold. Now, would I buy more gold compared to silver? I like to follow the gold-silver ratio. So, and typically if that ratio is around 80 or above 75, which is roughly where it is right now, I would rather stay more in silver or buy more silver. If it goes down to below 60, you know, I would rather be going into gold. But I mean, there's nothing wrong with buying some gold, obviously. So it becomes sort of a matter of preference as well. And you have to realize that depending where you are, in Europe, for example, there's no tax on gold, but there's a GST tax, a VAT tax, on silver, meaning if you buy physical silver, you have to pay 19%. So you don't have it in Singapore. But if you are somebody living in Germany, for example, it would make a lot of sense for you to buy your gold, you know, maybe keep it at home, but store the silver in Singapore with us, because you don't have to pay the 19% sales tax that you have in Germany. So you always get these sort of factors to look into. But everything else being equal, I'm still a silver buck and long silver at this point.
Okay. Another question from Carrie Ellen Wilder. She's asking if she has adequate supply of, let's say, gold and silver. What opinion do you have as far as the acquisition of them moving on to platinum, palladium, even rhodium?
Yeah, so what we realized as we built the reserve was that there's actually insurance companies are getting more and more worried about keeping rare metals in LME warehouses or warehouses which don't have certified security. So commodity warehouses. Yet these metals are too big to put into a gold vault. And that means that there's a big opportunity, you know, for these metals to come into a vault like ours. Now, in our case, we are a bonded facility, which means that even if the metal is not tax exempt, which in Singapore, you know, gold, silver, and platinum is tax exempt, palladium, rhodium is not, but we can store it tax free, so it's not an issue. The thing that you will find with these metals, though, is they're very illiquid right now. So when you buy rhodium and so on, selling it is sometimes a challenge. So you can make a market for it, but it's hard to find buyers. So if we are buying it and we are storing it, so there's only a small number of refineries that are providing it or providing it at a, you know, form that's easily to store. Because typically people want to have, say, a metal bar as opposed to having a sponge, which is what you might want for metal, for industrial metals. But having said that, now that we have the reserve and we have also bonded capacity of 15,000 tons, we essentially can look into these kind of metals, as well as metals like indium or germanium. And germanium is something which I find very interesting because germanium is used in semiconductors. And in the University of Vienna, they recently found out that there's some electrical properties of germanium, which makes it so that at a certain voltage, it sort of stops conducting. And the reason why it's interesting is it means you can make smart transistors. And in some cases, you can reduce the amount of transistors needed by 85%, which means your computer can use, you know, your CPU can become up to 85% smaller, which means a lot less expensive, which means germanium suddenly could become a very interesting metal for semiconductor industry. It's already being used, but its use might really go up, you know, 3 or 4 years down the line. And so I think germanium, for example, could be a really interesting metal. So what we are looking at towards the end of the year and as the reserve is getting ready is what sort of metals, you know, can we bring in and create a market on? And so rhodium is one of those. Right now, I don't know enough about rhodium to really be able to give you advice on that. Palladium makes, you know, has gone up so much. Why? Well, my understanding is palladium is being used as a catalyst, a catalytic converter for ICE, for gas engines. And palladium tends to be used for diesel. And, you know, with the diesel scandals, people are just sort of assuming we need less palladium and we need more we need less platinum and we need more palladium. But personally, between palladium and platinum, I think platinum is a better buy right now because platinum is very cheap compared to palladium. So Those are kind of my thoughts here. But as you might know, we've been storing nickel. When we started nickel, that was 3 years ago, it was about $12,000 per ton. We are now hitting $25,000 per ton because nickel is very important for EV batteries. So we've done it with nickel. We're going to be looking at other metals which we think are interesting. And then we'll figure out how we can make sure there's a supply and there's enough liquidity so we can offer it for you. But yeah, it's definitely something I'm interested to head towards.
Okay, moving on to the next question here. Excuse me. How big of a role do you see these wealth managers, family offices, as they move into precious metals?
I'm hoping it will be a very big role because that's where so much of that money is. And you see, when we started Silver Bullion, most of our customers, nearly all of them, are individuals. There might be high net worth people, but they're people like me in some way, you know, or entrepreneurs, people who sort of make their own decision. Spends the time to kind of look how it's being stored, builds the confidence in the store. But when you're dealing with a wealth manager who's managing money for somebody else, it's a little bit different because that manager has to think about, you have the IBM effect, essentially. And in other words, there's the thinking that in IT, if you buy IBM, you're safe, because nobody ever gets fired for buying IBM. But if you're buying, say, AMD chips, it might be cheaper, it might be better, but it's a not known thing. So I might get in trouble doing it. I'd rather buy IBM because it's safe, even though it might not be the best solution. So you have such sort of thing going on when you deal with wealth managers, where they're looking at you and saying, oh, well, your company is too new. You know, we only invest in companies which have been around for 12 years, for example, or you're too small, or, you know, they're feeling like, you know, do I really want to go in front of a committee and tell that committee that we should be putting bullion there? And so it's quite hard, you know, to sort of break into that world of institutional sort of wealth management and so on, because you need them to really feel like no matter what, nothing's ever going to go wrong. And I'm not going to be made fun of by my colleagues for saying that, you know, we should be buying precious metals. And so I think that with the reserve and with the facility which we are building, we will be able to get that sort of credibility and get mainstream wealth managers to start looking at us and to start saying, okay, precious metals actually make sense and they're being stored in a way. Basically, I just need them to spend the time to look in depth at what we're doing. And if I can get that, then, you know, I hope to be able to get them to the point where these wealth managers will be standing in front of the committee and essentially get, you know, third-party funds to come in. And if we can do that, I'm hoping that we can have a much bigger effect of, you know, the industry as a whole to slowly start moving into precious metals. Because right now, when I speak with people, gold is still an afterthought. It's still that barbarous relic. And when, you know, you explain to them difference between paper and gold and physical, you know, they go, aha, 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 but they don't really believe it. And so it's sort of a slow but persistent journey where people slowly need to be made aware and slowly start getting it. And so there's a lot of, you know, there's about 12 things we need to do, I believe, to sort of get to that point. And the reserve is one of these points. And we're working through all of them while essentially making sure that we're constantly improving the safeguards and systems that we created. So I'm pretty confident that we'll get the wealth managers in there. And when we do, it's almost like a force multiplier, like it was done in the military, because now you will get the third-party wealth measures coming there and essentially getting clients to buy physical gold and silver. And so my aim with that is to really start accumulating more and more of the metals and create a certain critical mass so that in the future at some point, you know, if there's a systemic problem, we could potentially become an exchange, or we could do something. We'll have to see how it goes, but that's the idea. So wealth managers are an important part of that, because so much wealth is tied up with wealth managers, private banks, family offices, and I think that's an important next step.
Okay, let me run through some of your questions here. John Bethea, he has a question here. What if the government secures the vault or some type of nationalization takes place?
Yeah, so that's essentially the reason why we built our own vault. When you're dealing with somebody, you have to look at two things. You have to look at counterparty risk, and you have to look at jurisdictional risk. Jurisdictional risk basically is saying, whose laws are you operating under? And counterparty risk is, who are you working with? And the issue is that every time you work with somebody, that somebody is going to be under a different set of laws or new set of laws. So if you want to protect yourself from a nationalization, first of all, you need to know who your counterparty risk is. And if your counterparty risk is a bank, well, first of all, that bank is going to have to follow US law no matter what, no matter where they're located. And if that bank outsources to, say, a global vaulting provider, that vaulting provider is going to have to follow US law pretty much no matter what, because they most likely have a lot of jurisdictional exposure to the US. And that's why back in 2012, when we built our storage system, I had to sign the storage contract saying that with the external vault operator, saying that I have to identify the vault operator against nationalization by any country anywhere. And so what we did to prevent that is to build our own vault, have our own facility, and ensure that we are only subject to Singapore law. How do we do that? Well, everything is insourced, which means we don't outsource anything. So we are sort of where the buck ends. It's you're just dealing with us, nobody else. And we are only under Singapore jurisdiction because we're only having material presence in Singapore. And so if the US were to nationalize gold, for example, then we would simply not recognize it because of foreign jurisdiction. I mean, what if Burundi is nationalizing gold, right? It's not like we have to turn the gold over to Burundi, and we feel we don't have to turn it over to the US. We can do that because we don't have assets or significant material exposure back to the US. But of course, we have to listen to what Singapore says. So if the US comes to us, we are saying, okay, we don't recognize the authority to do that, go to the Singapore courts. And I think the way these things will work out in practice is that if the US were to nationalize gold again the way they did in 1933, which was an executive order, which happened very quickly, and you had 2 weeks to comply, it will all come down to what the vault operators are going to do and what your dealer is going to do. And if they have US exposure, they're going to have to follow US law. And I spoke with people in industry for a lot about this very issue. And, you know, the typical answer is it depends on the lawyers. The honest answer usually is, all right, we'll go right back to the US if you have US exposure. So in our case, because we don't have it, it will essentially us, we will be telling the US government, go deal with it in a Singapore court, and then it will sort of end up being stuck in Singapore court. And since the next question becomes, would Singapore nationalize gold on behalf of the US? And I would say Singapore will probably be the last country, to do so. I don't believe they will, because the most important assets that Singapore has is the confidence people have in Singapore as a jurisdiction. And so if Singapore were to nationalize gold, since that will be an economically, you know, I would say almost like an economic suicide, because it will essentially, you know, endanger Singapore as a trusted jurisdiction. And keep in mind, Singapore is just been ranked by the Heritage Foundation as the country with the highest degree of economic freedom. So it is a place here where private property, you know, is very much considered sacred. And Singapore has a history of sort of standing up with foreign countries telling it what to do. And CESAR essentially is the reason why in practice, you know, we will not be surrendering the gold and silver. And I think by the time anything will be had in Singapore courts, the whole thing will probably be, you know, more or less settled already. So, yeah, that's pretty much the answer I have to say. So I'm highly confident that even if the U.S. were to nationalize, and, you know, it would not nationalize gold or silver in Singapore with us.
Okay, another question here. In fact, I'll throw two at there since they kind of unfold into each other. John Bethea, how do we in the U.S. buy metals at your vault? And Mr. Nguyen, how then is storage fees calculated, by weight or by value?
Yeah, so that's a good question, especially the second part. So you, one way you can go to silverbullion.com.sg, our company, and you can buy gold and silver from us, platinum, palladium. We have about 700,000 ounces of silver that we own outright. So when you buy it, you know, as long as it's in stock, it'll immediately sort of become yours. You don't have to wait for deliveries, and about 4,000 ounces of gold. So you go to silverbullion.com.sg and make an account. So about the storage fees, the industry usually stores on a percentage of value. We are not doing it that way. The reason why percentage of value is used is because usually it's being outsourced to a vault operator, and the vault operators are storing on a percentage of value. It's just sort of tradition. In our case, however, when you're storing silver especially, you have two types of costs with it. One of it is the fixed storage cost, which in the case of silver are quite high. And then you have the insurance cost. Now, the insurance cost is a variable proportion, because the more silver goes up, the more you have to pay for the insurance and so on. But the fixed storage cost is really much higher than the insurance cost of these metals. So because of that, we are storing by weight, essentially. So our storage fee is per ounce of gold or per ounce of silver, regardless of what the value is. And what that means is the more silver and gold goes up in value, the lower the percentage that you're paying in storage fees. You can go to our website and you can see current rates, but essentially for gold, if I'm not wrong, in US dollar terms, it's around $7 or something per ounce per year, with gold being 1,900 right now. We're talking about maybe 35 basis points, 0.35% or something like that. That's fully insured, guaranteed, authentic, and so on and so on. And then for silver, if I'm not wrong, we're around 19 cents per ounce of silver or something along these lines, which then means you're looking at 0.8% or something based on current silver prices. But keep in mind, if silver doubles, then you're paying 0.4%. And we are confident we can maintain these prices because the new facility is giving us so much capacity that essentially as gold and silver prices go up, we don't need to raise, you know, say storage fees.
Okay, one more question here. Dylan Sawyer, he's asking, why wasn't it built underground? What if a natural disaster or a man-made disaster happens, like a plane flying into it?
Yeah, actually, building it underground, you see, there's not much of a theft risk in Singapore, and building it underground wouldn't really be that much of an improvement in my point of view, because because the actual theft from outside and the facility and the security is already there. Now, what if a plane crashes into it? Let me put it this way. A good example was 9/11, right? There was a lot of gold and silver that was stored underneath the buildings that ended up collapsing. And you can't really destroy gold and silver. Worst case, it will essentially melt. And you would then have to recover it, and you would have to cast it back into bars. But the cost of doing so is quite small. I mean, we're talking maybe 0.5% to 1% or so. And very worst case, our insurance, you know, covers it. So the chance, again, of a plane, you know, crashing into the building, spewing fuel onto the gold and silver and burning it and melting it, again, it wouldn't be destroyed. It will just be a matter of recasting it. So in that sense, it's not really that big of a of an issue. And building the whole facility underground, it'll probably take us, you know, a lot more money and 10 years, and we probably never get the governmental approval of doing such a thing at that scale. And there really wouldn't be that much benefit in practical terms of doing it.
Okay, moving on. I guess we kind of touched on this already, what other metals would be going into the reserve. So let me move forward to another question. It's also going to be a center for alternative assets such as trading, authentication, digitization, collateralization of high-value luxury items. Timepieces are digital assets. You touched on that a bit, but can you give us a little bit more? Because the reserve is so much more than just a silver and gold vault.
Correct. We are calling it Alternative Asset Center to sort of reflect the nature of where we are heading with this. Gold and silver, you know, are the obvious metals. And of course, that's the center of what we're doing, especially with silver bullion. But then we're having other tenants come in, which are specialists in other areas. So I mentioned the watches, and I think that will be very interesting because a lot of interest out there on from the watch side. And we then have the auction series. So that could potentially result into art. It can result into collectibles and so on. And keep in mind, auctions are essentially a way, a price discovery way, right, of taking an asset which is not liquid, such a piece of art, and trying to figure out what the price is. So because we have all this capacity and because we are bonded, you know, it makes sense for us to sort of offer these sort of services. And we're working with some parties right now to see how it develops. And the beauty is, as you're putting these sort of services together, say you get more than the sum of its parts, because a person might go to the reserve because it has, you know, this really high-end collection of watches in the perpetual vault. And holders of the watches, they can actually choose to take bids for it. So, you know, watch collectors might come in there and put their watch there, or people who might want to come to see their watch and potentially buy it. Now, as these people go to the reserve, they will see the gold and silver, and maybe these people have never thought about buying physical gold and silver, but they will now see, hey, this is something that's actually interesting. Maybe I should buy some physical gold and silver. So you can see, as you bring diverse sort of interests together in a facility like this, they are being made aware of, you know, these other settings. So there's, they're basically building on each other. And that's an important sort of point that we want to create. And what we identified are essentially four areas of type of assets that we want to store. Precious metals, which is clear. Rare industrial metals, which I mentioned earlier. Watches, which can be authenticated, and they act, you know, almost like, they're starting to act almost like an asset class. And then you have collectibles, rare items, art, and so on, which is something quite new for us. We're basically looking for some partners to sort of develop that. So these are the type of assets that we're storing. But now on the services side, we are providing storage, of course, highly secure. We are providing liquidity for gold and silver. Watch liquidity will be provided by another party. If the auction houses come in, that's what they do. They provide liquidity for the art and, you know, other items like this. And we then provide authentication services for gold and silver. We've been doing that for a decade now. We'll have two testing labs. One is a bulk testing lab, essentially, and another one is a testing lab, which we use to show customers how the testing is happening. The watch workshop, essentially, one of the primary purposes is to authenticate watches using something called forensic authentication. It's a very detailed process of making sure the watch is the real deal and checking that it's not been stolen and so on. And then for art and art items like that, the idea is to have third parties come in to essentially evaluate it. And in order to track all of this, we developed a system called Gramchain, which is one of our other big projects we're working on. And Gramchain is an asset tracking and event recording system. So essentially, whether it's a watch or a gold bar or an art piece, it will be recorded. You can put events on top optionally. That includes an evaluator coming in, that includes an auditor coming in, that includes a provenance expert coming in. And so as you're putting these sort of statuses in, you can essentially have a third party decide what to do with it. And so as far as users, Gramchain is ideal to digitize assets. So if you want, for example, and you have art or you have something else, you can create a non-fungible token out of it. Or if you have physical gold, you can create a fungible token out of it. So these are options that we're working towards. And the other options that we provide, as I think most of our readers are listeners are aware, is we have a peer-to-peer lending system, secured lending system, which we started back in 2015. And with the system, essentially, you can take a gold bar or some other asset, you can take a loan against it, and that money is coming from another customer with us, and we essentially act as an escrow in between. And with that system, you know, we are now doing 130 million Singapore dollars per year, which is about $100 million US, and we did about 10,000 loans. So we got 10, 12 loans per day, now going through that system. So essentially, we'll be able to expand the peer-to-peer lending system to add some additional collateral assets. And so when you put all these things together, we are thinking that we are making physical alternative assets much more attractive and, you know, unlock value in many different ways, while always making you the owner of the item, and that is your private property. And that combination of things, you know, my career has been developing financial systems, and now I'm essentially going out and figuring out how to take physical items and create all these capabilities on top of it. And that's what I've been doing for the last 15 years, essentially. So the reserve is sort of putting all of these things together. And out of that, I think we'll get much more than the sum of its parts.
Okay, moving on. Silver Bullion has been managing a system where your customers who store with you in the Star Storage program, you know, they're able to use their collateral for a P2P loan, which we touched on here. Excuse me. And with the reserve scheduled to be opened later this year and the variety of customer holdings that store well, will there be, excuse me, other things that customers or clients can use as collateral for P2P? I know you mentioned art. Will that be one of them? Will the watches be another thing as well?
So I don't know. I mean, it that's too far out there because we're still in talks on, you know, whether we can do the auctions because you need to have a special permit to do that or allow auction to be run in the facility. But with watches, I'm definitely keen to go into watches. And for those who don't know about the peer-to-peer system, essentially, it's a very safe system. And we have something which is called the sweeper fund, which essentially, you know, it's essentially my own money, which is in there to come in whenever something goes wrong. And because of that, I feel that, because I'm thinking there might be some people which are using peer-to-peer, which are taking a loan against gold, and they're comfortable with gold, they might not be comfortable with a watch. But I think adding a watch and understanding the watch market, it can actually be a very safe collateral. And because of safe collateral, and it can ensure that the valuation is definitely a below market, or a valuation which can easily be liquidated. And because I'm putting my own sweep of fund money at risk on there, I essentially think that it makes a lot of sense to add watches to the peer-to-peer system. And yeah, I think it will end up being a very successful sort of thing, and help us peer-to-peer, and as well as get a lot more people who own watches right now incentivized to come to the reserve, put it in the perpetual vault, and then hopefully also become aware of gold and silver. So that's sort of the plan. Whether we do other assets, we kind of have to see. We just want to make sure that the asset is absolutely safe, you know, as a collateral, that keeps on being our main motivator.
Okay, let me move on over to the website real quick, thereserve.sg. A few of the things here, born out of the 2008 financial crisis, which we touched on, the timeline, 2009, your first silver bar arrived here in Singapore. 2011, Star Storage was established. 2014, the safe house was built and established. In 2015, the peer-to-peer program, as you mentioned. 2021, started building the world's largest capacity vault. So within this, I'd have to say you're a visionary. 5 years down the road, though, from this interview, what do you see as the reserve's position being in Singapore and being the world's highest capacity mega vault?
To some degree, it's wait and see. I mean, what I'm afraid that we are heading towards a lot of financial instabilities. I mean, we're seeing what's happening. We had COVID, we're now having Ukraine. Things have a way of happening that we don't expect. But at the same time, we all know that the US dollar is being printed to a degree that something's going to go wrong at some point. And so there's some sort of big crisis coming. And the reserve is meant there to stand as a safe haven when that happens. That's sort of what my goal is. That's what I'm envisioning it to be and remain, whatever we're doing. You know, that's the first order of priority. So what's going to happen 5 years from now? It's hard to predict these things because of the. It depends what the world is going to be like. But you know, my current expectations will be that it would essentially become hopefully one of the most popular ways of storing gold and silver, physical. And I hope that it will be able to send a message to the broader markets to sort of say, hey. Look at what counterparty risk is, look at jurisdictional risk, look at what the US dollar is, look at what our financial system is. It does make sense to take 10% of your assets and put it in physical gold and silver in a safe place. It doesn't have to be the reserve, but the reserve hopefully is big enough to send that message out to get people to think about it. Because the vast majority of investors and people, they don't even think about these things. And we need to have a message to send that out. And building the reserve, you know, I think it will at least give people pause to sort of consider, maybe these guys are up to it or to something. Or maybe if they can build something this big, you know, maybe they're not just quacks. So that's sort of what I'm hoping, you know, the message will be to the bigger world.
Okay. Gregor, do promise to keep us updated on the progress of the reserve. Is there a place that the listeners can go to for updates, perhaps a knowledge base?
Yes, so silverbullion.com.sg, that's our main website. And, you know, of course, SBTV, which you're listening to. And there's going to be cereserve.sg has its own website as well. So that one will slowly be built out. But we'll be sending you updates. So we'll, as we are constructing it, we are making videos to sort of keep abreast on what it's like to build this vault and, you know, to sort of involve you a little bit if you're interested.
Okay, a few more questions from people here. I think we kind of touched on this as well. If the air is going to be maintained at the proper environments for the different things.
Yes. Climate control, humidity control, and the nitrogen fire system, so yes.
Okay. Okay, let me just run through a couple more questions here. Actually, a few comments here. Martin Clark, sounds pretty cool. I look forward to seeing it develop. And then we have Mr. Nguyen again. I hope to be a patron of the reserve. We all know wealth is built 1 ounce at a time. Couldn't be a more true statement. Gregor Gregersen, we thank you for your time spending with us here today, talking about the reserve, letting us know what's coming on ahead. And I do hope that we can do it again soon. And customers, clients, I think they feel pretty safe with you. So we appreciate that.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you also, Gregor. Okay. So that was Gregor Gregersen, kind enough to give us some time to talk about the reserve, his opinions on things like silver and gold, where the world is, the financial system, and all these other things. You know, again, this is a time right now where, you know, none of us, perhaps we could never have predicted, but nonetheless, we're going through it and we do need options. And that's a big part of this, is to have options out there. So again, Gregor, I appreciate you being here. Let me take a look at a few more questions or comments, and then I'll be heading out as well. Let's see. Neil Han, do we have a live cam? I think we'll talk about that, but I think also if you're a person who's storing some gold and silver in there, I don't know if you would be comfortable with a live cam on all the time. So, and I think it's something we'll have to discuss. That's a good question there. Let's see. Mr. Osman, can we sell the bars without taking it out? Absolutely. You can sell it back to us 24/7. There is a feature on the website where you can just go ahead and click on sell your bars or your parcels, as they'll be in parcels. And then what will happen is we can wire the money to your bank account, which is why we ask for a bank account and a currency, a preferred currency for you when you first do sign up. So absolutely, you can buy it 24/7. You can also sell it 24/7. Also take out a loan, put in a loan request and get it collateralized. So it's a good question there. Good question there. Let's see. Yeah, Neil Han, it can, a remote audit can be done. Absolutely. And that's because we know the situation right now. Not everyone can or may come to Singapore, but still you do want to know about your assets, how they're doing, if they're there, and things like that. So we understand that. And it is going to be a feature also that the vault is going to have. As mentioned, this is a different time for some, a difficult time, and we understand it. We get it, and we're going to do things as openly and as transparently as we can. So that's a great question there. So I think, you know, Richard, you're welcome. I know, again, thank Gregor also for coming on. I think you had to rush off to a meeting, so I was trying to get him out of here on time. But yeah, you're welcome. Gregor, he does have a interesting view and an opinion on things. So, you know, with that, I'm going to say, you know, thank you for bearing with us. This was, had a bit of technical difficulties at the beginning, but thank you for hanging in there and coming on. Ted Oakley is going to be coming up, so do subscribe, and he's going to be followed by Lynette Zhang. So that one should be good as well. And one more thing, I had a message from one of our customers. He mentioned that, I guess it's not going to be a secret, but it was from Greg Hunter's communique That's Rob Kirby. Needs your prayers right now. He's battling with COVID, and he's having a pretty rough go with it. So if you can, send your prayers out to Rob Kirby. I don't know if it's my place to say how far along things have gotten, but just go ahead and do send your prayers out to Rob Kirby. So we want the best for Rob. Having said all of this, you know, as always, be a blessing as best you can, not a burden. Saddle up for what's coming ahead and silver up as well. I'll see you guys during the interviews this week and live stream in a couple weeks. Take care. Be safe. I'll see you guys soon. Thanks for joining us.